Welcome to this webinar on lean product development. Why a webinar on lean product development? Well, myself, as Tyler said, I work 25 years in innovation, and I did many innovation projects, and a lot of them went wrong or difficult. And so I was always thinking, how could you do improvement better? And some 4 years back, I encountered or was involved in lean product development, in the first steps for us. And I was very impressed by lean product development. Impressed because of its simplicity and because of its holistic approach. For this, I was very enthusiastic on this lean development, first by reading the books and later on by doing projects using this theory. So I'm very enthusiastic on this, and we within Philips, we see the first results of this approach. And that's why we want to present this lean product development to you. What will we discuss today? So we will start with a small introduction of Philips, then a why lean product development, some of the elements, implementation aspects that are of course always very important. And in the end, I will tell something on the difference between lean product development and lean innovation. Okay, first a slide on myself, although the most has already been said. My background is mechanical engineering, but when I started within Philips 25 years ago, I started as a software developer, so that's kind of new. And I have different roles within Philips. I've been a project leader, group manager, as Tyler said, and last year I'm consulting. If you'd characterize the work I'm doing, I would call myself an improver. Improving processes, but also helping people to improve. And the topic I'm working upon is lean product development. Okay, something on Philips. Philips has a nice definition, and that's what I put in the slide. We are a global company, so a very large company, over 100,000 of employees. And we are what we call leading businesses in some areas, where we create value with meaningful innovations. And that means at the heart of our business is the innovation. So we have a lot of experience within Philips on innovation, and we use it for improving the lives of people in the health and well-being area. We are divided in three sectors. The first sector is healthcare, maybe you know the X-ray machines, stuff like that. There's a sector on consumer lifestyle. They make television sets, coffee makers, razors, etc. And a sector on lighting, very involved in the latest LED technology, of course. Okay. So within Philips, you have, of course, a lot of groups. Well, I'm from a central group, around 50 people big. It's called Industry Consulting, and we help Philips divisions with what we call business realization, and business creation. So we help them taking the business creation axis with the whole value stream from supplier to customers. And we work on, for instance, industrial engineering, supply chain management, for instance, reducing stock, quality and reliability, and industrialization and ramp up. On the business creation part, we work on innovation management, road mapping and programming. We do a lot on speeding up processes. There is where this lean comes in, and we are heavily involved in the end user driven innovation activities within Philips. So we are really founded in innovation, and as well the business creation part as business realization part. Okay, so why do we work on lean product development? Well, we see that there's a lot of pressure on innovation, and not only Philips, but all companies having to come up with new products in a very frequent and rapid way. And that high pressure means also that there's a high pressure on the effectivity and efficiency of innovation. Effectivity, making the right products, and efficiency, making them in the right way, or developing them in the right way. So there are a lot of programs on improving this innovation part. But we see that it's very difficult to get sustainable improvement when you do improvement. You can see that on the pictures I have on this slide. And you see that typical improvement programs, they lose up a lot of energy and then fall back again. And it's very difficult then to improve. Within the lean approach, we think we can improve in a more continuous way. So that's why lean is important. Another one is that we have seen that in manufacturing, lean is common practice. Every factory you walk in nowadays, you can see that they are working on lean. So you see it on the striping on the floor, on the posters, on the stocks in between the machines, etc. So it's becoming really common practice. And there is a lot of to learn from that lean in manufacturing. And that's why we say, okay, let's see what we can learn in manufacturing and how can we use it in innovation. A last part is that we see that there are some lean companies which are already applying lean product development and which have some impressive results. For instance, to mention a result, one lean company is saying that they develop twice as much products as they used to, with only the half of the staff compared to their peers. So very impressive. And that's why we say, okay, we need to implement this lean. Okay, so what is already happening within Philips? Later on I will have some more examples. But let's start with a very global view. So lean in operations or manufacturing is around for a couple of years now. In the software area, we apply what we call agile programming for quite some years now. And agile programming can be seen as the same as lean development, but then in the software environment. So we used it already a lot of time by using scrums, sprints, etc. And we have a lot of results in that area. We started with lean product development, as I said, some a couple of years ago. And there's already one site here in the Netherlands using this lean techniques. And they have achieved that they have two times as many projects with the same total innovation cost. So big progress made. Okay, so this is within Philips. So where did it start? And then I have to go back in time a little bit. This is a picture, it's from the National Center for Manufacturing Science, and they did an investigation a couple of years back on the differences between lean development companies, of companies using lean development, and traditional companies. And the outcome was very, maybe you should call it very strange. So what they found is, and I will not discuss all the lines here, what they found is that the engineering productivity within lean companies was around 80%, whereas the productivity within traditional companies was around 20%. And you will say, 20%, that's strange because that's one out of five working days. How can that be? Well, you have to see that when you are in a project, and the project you are working upon for a year, and at the end of the year the project is stopped because it did not become a success, the whole year was in fact not productive if you did not take care of capturing all the knowledge you learned during that year. So that's a way you lose a lot of productivity. Also by having a lot of meetings, and I can see it in Europe, we always have a lot of meetings. Another typical observation they made is looking at the knowledge shared across projects. So they saw that in traditional companies they worked upon knowledge, but it was not systematically stored, meaning we did a project and at the end of the project we sat together, what did we learn, write it in a report, put it in a cupboard and forget about it. So in the lean companies they are capable of storing this knowledge in a very systematic way, And you can see it here in this picture. The last one I want to discuss is about unplanned design loopback. So a design loopback is when you do a project and you start with a concept, and after a couple of months you say, well, it's not the right concept. We should use a better concept. So you go back in your project and it is unplanned, so your project total lead time will be longer as planned. So you lose a lot of time. And what you typically see is that in traditional companies, there is a lot of these unplanned design loopbacks. In fact, I've seen a lot of them. And in those lean companies, they almost never have these loopbacks. So there must be something really different between what lean companies are doing and what traditional companies are doing. I will come later on what is then the difference. First, I will look at the learnings from manufacturing and how can we use them. Okay, so simple question. Why not just apply lean manufacturing methods? Because they are proven, and some companies have tried to do that. But what you see, what you typically see, is that innovation or development organizations are quite different than manufacturing organizations. So in manufacturing organizations, a cycle or lead time can be a couple of minutes or weeks, but in development, projects can take years, several years before a project is finished. So the lead time is quite different. Also, when you do manufacturing, you know in the beginning exactly what you're going to get, because it's specified, it's tested, and you make repeatedly a lot of the same products, so you know what you're going to get. When in development, doing a project, there's always a fuzzy start, because you do not know exactly what you're going to get. You do not know exactly how long it's going to take, how many resources are needed, because every project is in fact unique. So there are big differences between manufacturing and development organization impacting the way you do lean in an organization. But, and that's on the lower part of this slide, I've been to a conference on lean product development 3 weeks back in Sweden, and there was a very nice definition on lean product development, and I think it's a generic definition because it also applies to manufacturing. I've written it down. It's very simple, saying lean is solving problems for continuous improvement by people doing the work. So it's about solving problems, not about models, trying to introduce them because maybe we go faster. No, solving problems, and only for continuous improvement. So not just once and then go on with our lives again. No, build upon solutions. And the last one, equally important, by people doing the work. So sometimes we say we have someone who does the improvement in an organization, and someone else is doing the work. Well, lean typically says, no, the one doing the work is the one who should do the improvement or solve the problem. Okay, so this is a very generic definition, and it can be used in as well manufacturing as in development. Okay, still, we could learn a lot from manufacturing. So I have some examples of that. Maybe you know, when you're talking about lean, many times we talk about the waste, reducing waste in a process. So in manufacturing, a lot of attention is given to waste in process. In fact, they have what they call the seven wastes of manufacturing. What you can do is take those seven wastes and translate them into development. So I have in the picture, I have an example. It's about the waste of waiting. So the waste of waiting in operations or manufacturing is very simple. It's an operator on a machine waiting for materials, waiting for a tool, or waiting for a machine to be repaired. And you can typically see it because he's just hanging around smoking a cigarette or whatever. So it's very clear. So translating this into development, you can say, okay, waiting. So people waiting for information, an engineer waiting for information of a supplier, or waiting for a specification or the outcome of analysis. So waiting. Another one is information waiting for people. So someone has made an analysis, a report, and is lying around for someone to pick it up. And for the managers under us, there's also another one, that's engineers waiting for decisions. In most cases, management decisions. Do we go left? Do we go right? How much is the budget? Etc. And they are waiting for a decision. And one of the problems with this waiting is that it's much more difficult to see, because those engineers are not hanging around. They are behind their notebooks and their workstations. They are just working, but you cannot see it. Are they looking at a web page, or are they making a specification? It's much more difficult to see, but still you have to do it. So this is an example of a waste commonly known in manufacturing translated to development. You can also do that for others. So I have some examples on this. So for instance, overprocessing, making a product too good, too well. In development, you can say, I make a report and the report is never used. Or another one, inventory. So within the manufacturing, you try to prevent inventory. Within development, where you do a project and you say, okay, we should do another project now because this has more priority, and we stop this process and this old project and we pick it up later again. And what you typically see then, it lies around for maybe a year, people have left, the knowledge is not up to date anymore, and it's just wasted, in fact. So I call that partially work done, which is a form of waste. And another one is overproduction, so too much detail. And the last one, unnecessary motion, also an interesting one. So in operations, you can see the operator walking for tools or walking for whatever. In development, you typically see people, engineers, searching for information. And that can be documents, that can be old drawings, that can be a supplier brochure or whatever. And we did a measurement within one of the companies I was with, and there we measured that on average, every engineer lost half an hour a week on searching for documents. So that's a form of waste. So what you see is that you can translate those waste of operations, manufacturing, into development. But within development, and that is because the nature of development is different, there is another waste, and that's even more important. And we call that the waste of knowledge. Because development, it is a knowledge creating organization. So knowledge is at the center. And you can waste knowledge very easily. I have some examples here on this slide. So for instance, what we call scatter. So when you are doing too many projects in parallel, and you are switching between projects, and you are so much working on the switching and keeping up to date with all the projects, with everything which is going on, that your productivity or your knowledge building is very low. So too many projects in parallel, it's the waste of scatter. Another one, that's very known, I think, is what we call the waste of handoff. So an example here. When I am within development and my product is written down in all kind of drawings, technical product drawings, and I give it to manufacturing, they only receive the drawings, and they have to interpret the drawings and see, okay, what did he mean here, and hey, this could be done in a different way, and they spend a lot of time on just understanding what the drawing is. And the reason for that is that you can only transfer 20 to 30% of what you know via those documents. So you have a lot of hand-off, and you lose knowledge, because we're discussing waste of knowledge. Another one is what we call the waste of visual thinking. And this might be the biggest waste, because when you start developing a product and you think there's a market for that product, and after developing the product the market was not there, you did wishful thinking. And you spent a lot of time and effort on creating a project where there was no market for. It was wishful thinking, and so we call it making decisions without facts and operating blindly, mainly the without facts. So you do not take fact-based decisions, but you take decisions on belly feeling. And that has a lot of risks, and we can lose a lot of knowledge there. The last one, is I already mentioned that earlier, what we call discarded knowledge. So when you do a project, you are not capable of capturing the learnings and putting them in new products, then you do what we call discarding of knowledge. You lose the knowledge and you do not do cross-project learning. Okay, so I discussed a lot on waste of manufacturing, typical waste of development. Now let's look at lean product development and what can we do about this. So what we did, we read a lot of books, we studied projects, we had people from university come in, students to work with, and what we developed was what we call the lean development wheel. And that's what you see on this picture. And these are in fact 8 areas where you can improve, or 8 aspects. So I will not discuss all those aspects because time is too limited for that. Maybe you recognize some. I will discuss some of them. For instance, value focus. Because that's of course one of the main things. Because you have to devise a way how to separate waste from adding value in an activity. So you have to focus on your value to see what is not adding value. A definition of value in development is not that easy, but what I got is value is only when you create reusable knowledge, so which is used in all projects, then you call it value. And you will also have to see who is your customer. Is that the end consumer? Yes. And it is also the manufacturing environment which will make the products. You have different customers. And you add value for those customers. Okay, value focus. Another one, it's what we call visual communication. It's very important in this lean part because visual communication helps you easily see where problems are. As you will remember, so in the base definition of lean, that was the problem solving. So you have to have very good ways to identify problems. I have an example of this. Got it? I have an example of this. And this is what we call an OBEA, or a project room, where you can see all the visuals on the walls of the project room. And when you look well, you can see some red dots. I don't know if your the quality of the pictures is well enough. There are some red dots on this wall. So you can easily see where there are problems and where you should take care of and put extra effort in. So typically visual management, this is an example from Philips in Singapore. Okay, so I skip the integral project leaders and the teams of responsible experts. I will briefly stand still with the lean culture of continuous improvement, because this is one of the base, the fundamentals of lean, yeah? As well lean in manufacturing as in product development. And the difficult, this also makes it very difficult to implement lean, because you have to change your culture. And things in a lean culture are, for instance, that you constantly look at flow of processes, so making projects flow in your organization. You always look at pull instead of push, so pulling activities instead of pushing activities. Another one, I think, it's very important in development, also in manufacturing, is what we call go see. So it means when there is a problem, go see for yourself. And for development, it means go see on the factory floor what is really happening, or go see with the customer, so that you see it in the environment, the problem occurs. So there are some elements in the culture which are different from traditional companies. Okay, I skip the reduce waste, overburden and variation, and come to the set-based concurrent engineering. Because I think this is at the heart of lean product development when you look at knowledge and knowledge management. Okay, so set-based concurrent engineering. This is a difficult topic, and I will only discuss it very briefly. And there's a lot of things behind it I will not discuss, maybe some other time. So what is this set-based concurrent engineering? It's different than the concurrent engineering we knew in the past. It's more about developing systems by dividing it into subsystems and developing solutions for all subsystems and slowly converging the subsystems into the end product you want to bring to the market. In contrast to what I said in the beginning, of quickly selecting a solution and then developing it, and then at the end saying this was not right and we have to do the design loopback. So this is a way to prevent design loopbacks, because you studied a lot of alternatives and the chance that you have the right product at the end is much higher. You will say, when I do this kind of development, I will need a lot of more resources in the beginning to find, of define all the alternatives. And it's true. So you need more time there. So you spend more time up front, have more benefit at the end. But there is another big difference. When you have defined then your end product, and you say, okay, now I want to make a high-end version out of this, or a low-end version, you can go back to the alternatives you studied and then pick other solutions. So the knowledge you build in the beginning of a project is not lost. And even when you go to a next project, you can reuse all the knowledge you build. But what you have to do, and that was also in the beginning, what you have to do is very systematically store your knowledge. And that's what I depicted in the right bottom of your screen. So it's very important to have a good way of capturing knowledge. And the example here is using knowledge sheets. And it's also very important to have a way to compare solutions for a subsystem. And a way to compare solutions is what we call trade-off curves. So trade-off curves and knowledge sheets are a way to capture your knowledge. And when you do this right, let me go to the next slide. When you do this right, you will see that you have two value streams you are working with. One value stream creating all the knowledge, another value stream creating the products. So, and what you see in this picture is that the products are developed using, built upon the knowledge you have created. So you really are becoming a knowledge creating company. Okay. So this is in short set-based concurrent engineering, and you have seen it, if you might have seen that because you use high-end and low-end products, you are really using platform-based development. So platforms are also very important in this area. Okay, so this gives a flavor on what lean product development is. Of course, there's a lot more behind it. But now let's look at some of the implementation aspects. So, how to implement? Is there one way to implement lean product development? And there are a lot of questions on this, of course. I've picked three questions and I will go into detail of them. So, I will look at the project or functional axis. What do you choose? What do you do with the fuzzy front end? And is there an implementation sequence which is usable for all improvement project. So let's look at that. Let's start with the project and functional access. So when you look at a project, you can typically see that a project consists out of what we call microprocessors. So every project consists out of microprocessors like making a 2D drawing out of a 3D model, like building a prototype, like making a specification, like making a report or whatever, or doing an analysis. And a project is in fact configuring all those microprocessors. What you typically see is that those microprocessors, they fit within one department or are on the cross boundary of two departments. And when you look at Lean and you want to improve, you can look at two axes. You can say, okay, I will look at my project axis, because for many Lean implementations, we want to look at shortening the cycle of the throughput time of projects. And then you can say, okay, how can I manage my projects best, knowing this microprocessors? But when you really want to do sustainable improvement, you have to do that through the functional axis, so in a department. So for instance, in Yero is the factory engineering. Let them do an improvement project, which then holds for all the product projects coming along. So you do it in two ways. Let's look at the uncertainty, so the fuzzy front end. Fuzzy front end is always a bit difficult. What you can do, you can say, how do we look at projects? In fact, projects are reducing uncertainty. So in the beginning of a project, nothing is certain. So you know maybe some boundaries, but you do not know exactly how the product is going to look like. You do not know how much money is going to cost, how much resources will be involved. So a lot is unknown in the beginning of a project. At the end of a project, on the other hand, everything is known because the project is on the table and the money is spent. So a project is in fact reducing uncertainty. And that's what I draw in this curve. And what does Lean do then? Lean says, okay, we must try to replace this curve and have a lot more of uncertainty reduction in the beginning of a project. And we were in Philips, because I was discussing some of the Philips examples. We in Philips, we said, okay, we must separate those two processes. So we have a first process, which typically works on knowledge generation and on function creation, where there's a lot of creativity inside, and a lot of more risks, of course. And the other part is product development. So we have product development, where you only have low uncertainty, which means, and that's important, they are much better plannable. So the chance that they are finished on time is a lot higher. So this is a way for Philips to do what sometimes is called front-loading the process, or doing the knowledge creation more in the beginning of a project. Okay, so this is typically a way we do this in Philips with the fuzzy front end. The last question I had, and there are some examples of Philips there. So is there an implementation sequence? Can you say, do we do the implementation always in the right, in the same sequence? And I think not. Because I think it depends on the type of organization you're in. So for instance, if you are in a research and development organization, I think your implementation should focus on the knowledge. And an example we have within Philips is for our LED business. So you know, a very booming business at this moment, the LED business, but also a business where a lot of knowledge is created at the moment. So what we do within the LED business is focusing on systematically capturing the knowledge we create on this LED part. What you see, by the way, the lamp depicted is the new lamp we brought to the market just recently. It's very powerful. Okay, that's for Philips. Another organization is where our development needs to be more efficient. So they are running for projects for many years now, but management sees they have to be much more efficient. So a way to deal with that is starting with continuous improvement, also mentioned in the beginning. And an example here is a project I was involved in with a Dutch bed manufacturer, which develops beds, I've drawn one, and typically said, we need really to improve the process by making it more efficient. Another example, it's from Philips again, it's an engineer-to-order organization. So you can imagine that you have standard products and sometimes you need some specials for special customers. And when you have such a kind of organization, you always need to do some engineering to order, as we call it, before you can deliver the product to the customer. And what we saw in this with Philips Luminaires is that the process of this engineer to order took typically 2 weeks. And that was because a lot of parties were involved for the order collection, for sending information to the customer, receiving information, for making the small design, for setting up manufacturing, etc. So it took always 2 and even more weeks. So what we did is typically focus on the flow of that engineer to order process. And we took all the waste out of the process and we put everybody involved in the process together in one room. And we were able to reduce this process to only 2 days. So what you typically see in this kind of organization, you need a different solution than in a research and development organization, for instance. In general, I think you should determine the problem you want to solve, and I think it's important to find a coach or someone who can help you, and especially help you with getting a new perspective on the current activities you are doing. Because that's in many cases the problem. You're working in a certain way, and it's very difficult to think of new ways of working. Okay. So this about implementation. The last part I want to go to is what I call lean product development towards lean innovation. And what's the difference? Because of course it looks a lot the same. Okay, so when you look at what I've discussed now and you look at the arrows which I presented in the beginning, so the business creation and the business realization axis, you typically see that I've talked about product development. So improving, making product development faster. Now, when you take one bigger step, and you can see it already in this picture, there are a lot of processes next to this product development process. And that's what we say, okay, you're now talking about lean innovation. Because you then also try to improve the other projects, or other processes, sorry. So, for instance, the programming process. You try to get more cadence in your programming process or road mapping process. Another one is you have to have a more integral look at your platforms, not only platforms in development, but also how are they linked to manufacturing, how are they linked to sales, etc. Another one is that when you talk about lean innovation and you talk about much more processes, you have to do your value stream mapping, the mapping of your the value in your processes. You have to do that on the innovation level and not on the development level, which is much simpler. So you have to do your value stream mapping on your innovation level. So there I have an example from, this was in Hong Kong, for Philips Consumer Lifestyle, where we did value stream mapping for lean innovation. And what you see here is that we did in fact write down a current state. We had a workshop with all parties involved in this project around the table. You can see it on the left side, where we had what we call swim lanes, depicting all the departments involved. And in the white cards, you can see the activities which were done in the project. And in between, you see all kind of red cards. And the red cards, the problems were described. So there you write down your current state and the and the problems you find in that. On the other side, on the right hand side of the picture, it made a future state of the same process. So in fact, we started from the back towards the beginning, again looked at the activities, but then asking every time, what information did this activity need and where did it come from? So we looked at the pooling of information of activities. What you also can see is that there are a lot of red cards, but they are around the swim lanes, and because it are the old problems that put around the swim lane map, because we didn't want to lose the information. But what you also see is a lot of green cards inside inside the swim lanes, and that were the improvement opportunities. So we created a current state and a future state and a lot of improvement opportunities. Okay, so this is what we call then lean innovation, and you can see that it's not a small step from lean product development, as we call it, to lean innovation. Okay, so let's summarize. Let's have So we've seen a lean product development has proven results. You can look at lean companies. I was at the conference 3 weeks back, and there were some companies with real good results. You also have seen that lean is not simple. It addresses really the culture in your organization with the continuous improvement. So it's not that easy to implement. You can also see that we can learn a lot from manufacturing, but that development is different, and that within development you have to focus on the knowledge part. You have also seen that implementation depends a lot on the nature of your organization, though there is no standard way of implementing lean product development. You really have to look at, what do I want from this organization? And last but not least, you have seen it, the difference in scope between lean innovation and lean product development. Okay, so summary. So what, if you want to start tomorrow with this lean product development, what do you have to do? Well, first you have to see that lean is just not just a small project, but it's really a journey towards a new organization. Or a transformation, we sometimes call it within Philips. What we do, we can help you assist, we can assist you in this journey. And we can help you with awareness sessions, just like this one in fact, with opportunity scans, seeing what steps can you take best, training and coaching of teams, mainly improvement teams or management teams, and I showed an example of value stream mapping. Well, we do these kind of value stream mapping, and we help you see waste during those value stream map workshops.